back among the living.
What was the impetus to go out and make another movie?
Oh, well. We wrote the script about, I don't know, 1999, 2000, around in there, about 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
My ex-wife, Louise Stratton, and I wrote the script at that time for John Ritter and for Sybil Shepherd, and Louise was going to play the escort.
Mm-hmm.
John died tragically and very young, and just broke us up, both of us up. And so we put the script away.
Mm-hmm.
And years went by, and then I got to know Wes Anderson, and I got to know, well, actually I knew Wes Anderson by then already, but I got to know Owen. And I liked him very much, and I thought he could play the part, so we resurrected it.
Do you have a bunch of scripts in the desk, or?
No.
So you pretty much, the scripts you write, you end up making pretty much?
Pretty much, I guess. There's been a few that I didn't, I can't remember now. But this was the one we wanted to try to make. Now, you asked the impetus for the script, actually the script itself, how we came to write that in the first place, was because we were having a difficult time in our lives, financially, and a lot of other things were difficult. We were living in New York, but we were staying at one person's house, another person's house, we were traveling around, everything. I had just gone bankrupt for the second time. It was not a great moment. So we said to each other, let's write a comedy and cheer ourselves up. So we started to work on it. All we had at the beginning when we started was two ideas. One was to call it Squirrels to the Nuts, because I liked that phrase in Lubitsch's Clooney Brown, and I thought we could do something with that. And the other was the idea that somebody would pay an escort to stop being an escort. Because I had done that in Singapore when we were making St. Jack in 78. We had, because it's a movie about a pimp,
mm-hmm.
an American pimp in Singapore. We got to know a few escorts and we got to know a few madams and we used them in the picture and so on and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
And two of the girls particularly moved me, so to speak. Their stories and how they got to do what they were doing. And
mm-hmm.
I said, look, I'll give you a bunch of money if you promise you'll quit doing this and go home. And they did. So I gave them both what was a lot of money then, and not $30,000, but close in terms of mm-hmm. what it was then. It was about $7,000 or $8,000 each. And one of them went back to Bangkok and the other one went back to Malaysia. I never heard from them again, but they're in the movie.
Huh.
But they quit. They did quit the business.
So, doing a film. I mean, they always say the directors. The thing with the director is the legs go first.
The what?
They always say the first thing that goes with the director is the legs. is it harder to make a movie at this age?
No. No, I enjoyed it. We did it in 29 days.
Had you done that before? Had you had such a short schedule?
Shorter. I did a two-hour movie for Showtime, 2 full hours in 19 days, in 3 different locations, Quebec, and 2 locations in Toronto.
Mm.
It was brilliantly scheduled. I'm not kidding.
So were your? I mean, how long was something like St. Jack?
Oh, that was 60 days.
Yeah. So those.
We had a tiny crew, though. It didn't cost anything.
So was the economy of scale something that was always part of you as a director? I mean, people famously started with Targets, which was made
23 days.
Yeah, but you also were using other footage from other movies.
Well, but that movie, that didn't add up to more than 5 minutes.
Yeah.
I've done quite a few films in quite fast time. I did Cat's Meow, I think, was 30 days or 33 days or something like that. But for television, I did 24 days. 20 days,
mm-hmm.
I like moving fast. It just sort of turn the notch. Okay, faster.
So does the work suffer? Or do you
no.
feel like?
See, I don't shoot a lot of coverage.
Mm-hmm.
I don't shoot any coverage. So that makes it easier.
Mm.
And I don't shoot a lot of takes. I mean, unless I can't get the shot.
Mm.
For some reason, the actors can't do it or something. I don't do many takes. I do one or two, three, maybe. And as far as coverage, I don't cover at all. I just shoot, if it's a one-er,
mm-hmm.
all in one shot, that's it. We do it in one shot, and that's it. Walk away.
So is cutting much of an issue for you?
No. On What's Up, Doc, we showed the studio the picture with music 3 weeks after we wrapped. Same thing with Paper Moon. And I only cut 3 minutes out of a doc after a preview, and 1 minute out of Paper Moon after a preview. So that was very tight. Those pictures were shot very tight.
So, I mean, I guess the big complaint these days is that everything is changing and people don't want to make these kind of films anymore. Are you finding that, or is that, or do you feel like the world has changed, or is it just?
Oh yeah. They want to make movies for kids.
But there's a market for this kind of movie, no?
Well, there's the market for them. It doesn't mean they're thrilling for me. There's a market for a lot of junk.
Mm. But I mean for your film. I mean, I didn't mean for junk. I meant for your kind of film, a film like this.
I think it's a comedy. People want to laugh. We showed it in Venice. They laughed. We showed it in Palm Springs, they laughed the same way they did in Venice.
Mm-hmm.
We showed it in LA, they laughed the same way they did in Palm Springs. So when a picture gets the same exact laughs in every venue, you know it works.
Has that been wildly different? Have you had a situation where it's been wildly different?
I've had a situation where the laughs weren't always in exactly the same place, and the picture wasn't as big a success.
Mm. And how, I mean, it sounds like you, having gone through these different tosses and turns in your career, that how it's received and how it does the box office is pretty significant in terms of how your life is.
Well, it has a lot to do with how you go forward, yeah.
Because you don't really make a lot of money as a director normally, do you?
Pardon?
You don't really make a lot of money as a director.
Well, it depends on the budget.
Yeah.
The budgets on my last couple of pictures have not been high. Not been very big, so I didn't make much money, no.
So has your work been, have you been driven to work because you want to work, or is it always finding the thing that you want to do and then finding a way to get it made? How do you proceed?
Pretty much what's the latter.
Mm-hmm.
Something you want to do and then figure out how the hell you're going to get it made. With this last picture, Louise, after we decided we're going to try to do it with Owen,
mm-hmm.
Louise said, why don't we ask Noah and Wes Anderson and Noah Baumbach to be executive producers? Maybe that'll help get it made. Well, it certainly did.
Mm-hmm.
I asked them. They said, sure. Sure, Pop. They call me Pop. I call them my sons, son Wesley and son Noah.
So do you come in early on their cuts and see their films? Or
Occasionally. I saw an early cut of one of Noah's pictures, and I gave him some notes. I saw an early cut of a couple of Wes's, gave him some notes, yeah.
Is there a generational rift, or is it pretty much filmmaker to filmmaker?
Filmmaker to filmmaker, pretty much, yeah.
So it hasn't changed that much?
No, Wes gave me, they both gave me some notes on this one, which were good, so.
Mm-hmm. So do you feel like you're now, do you look back on your career, or are you a person who looks back?
Oh, David, I try not to.
Do you avoid it? I mean,
I don't avoid it because, I mean, somebody, the other day they ran What's Up, Doc at the New Beverly, Quinton's Theater, and I went down, they asked me to say a few words after the picture,
mm-hmm.
or I think it was after the picture, and so I watched the picture. Played the same way I did at the Radio City Music Hall in 1972, exactly the same, except it wasn't as big a place.
Mm.
It was great.
And is it fun to see it?
Yeah, but it works as well as it did. It worked the same as it did 40 years ago, so mm. That's encouraging.
Are there any of your films you wouldn't want to see again?
Yeah.
Any that are particularly exciting that you haven't seen, or you would like? Are you? I guess everything you have is probably on DVD and.
Yeah, I don't have all my stuff. My stuff is scattered around the United States, like Johnny Appleseed or something.
But do you? I mean, do you feel like you know, the great wise man of cinema that can talk about the past and?
Well, I've been through a lot of it, and I did know a lot of the people who started the whole thing, like Jack Ford or Howard Hawks or Alan Dwan. I said to Orson Welles, I said, I'm interviewing Alan Dwan. He said, Alan Dwan? Didn't he start directing sometime around the invention of the electric light? I said, yes, as a matter of fact. He invented one of the first early lights for movies. But I learned a lot from talking to those people, the people who created the art form, really.
Was it always going to be directing for you, you think, from an early age?
No, I was acting. I started as an actor when I was 15 professionally. So I've actually been in professional show business for 60 fucking years.
So was there a moment
60
where you,
fucking years.
60 fucking years. Was there a moment you decided to get out of acting?
Well, I never really got out of acting. I've been acting off and on all this time, just not that much. The Sopranos brought people's attention to the fact that I was an actor. Mm-hmm. A lot of people thought I was a critic who became a director. They skipped the whole acting part of my life, which started at 15, and I was directing in the theater. I directed my first play in New York when I was 20. And did about 6 or 7 plays that I directed in either New York or upstate New York before I ever did a movie. There was a moment when I was about 19 or 18, and I ending 19, I was studying with Stella Adler, the great Stella Adler. She was wonderful, studying acting. And I studied with her for 4 years, and one day, when I was about 18 or 19, I can't remember which, I was in a diner with five other actors, and we were talking. And I said, why don't I direct you guys in a scene? I don't know why I said that. To this day, I don't know why I said it, but it seemed like something to say. And there were five actors. I said, let's do a scene with five actors. What scene? I said, I don't know, let's find a good scene with five actors. So we found a scene from a play by Clifford Odets called The Big Knife. And I directed the scene. Now, scene class at Stella's meant two actors doing a two-hander or a monologue. Suddenly, five actors got up on the stage and played the scene. Well, it played very well. Mm-hmm. And the class applauded, and Stella stood up and said, very good, darlings, very good, very good, bravo. But you've been directed. Who directed you? And they pointed at me. I was standing in the back of the studio. Mm-hmm. Peter, they said. And she looked at me. She said, bravo, darling, brilliant. I thought maybe I should direct the whole fucking play. And I did. I got the rights from Odets. Mm-hmm. It took me a year to get $15,000. And I put it on. We got better reviews than the original production, which was directed by Lee Strasberg and starred John Garfield. Mm-hmm. And we ran 63 performances, which was respectable. Mm-hmm. It was a kind of success to steam. And then I was out of work. Mm. And then my career veered into writing about movies while I was figuring out what I was going to do in my next play.
Did you feel the drive for directing that you had for acting previous to that?
I liked directing. I liked it better than acting.
What's different? What was different about it?
Well, I could play all the parts. Really. Because I to this day, directing is a kind of outgrowth of acting. For me, when I direct a scene, I often will walk through the scene in playing a part, one of the parts, to see what the problems are as an actor. Then I can say, okay, this is the problem. Here's what you do, or here's what I suggest you do, or whatever. So it's I couldn't direct unless I could act it. I mean, I also give line readings many times, and the actors say, you give me a line. Streisand said, you give me a line reading? I said, well, you don't have to do it exactly that way, but it's give you an indication. Her agent calls me, "Are you giving Barbara Streisand liner?" I said, "This is the way I work. They don't have to follow it exactly." But after the third week, she would say, "Okay, how would you say it?"
So would that make you an actor's director or not an actor's director?
Well, some actors really hate it.
Yeah.
When you give them a line reading. But very few of them hate it. Owen would ask me, he says, "How would you say it?" Because he wasn't threatened by that. Mm. Ernst Lubitsch, the great Ernst Lubitsch, one of my favorite directors, used to act out every single part in every scene. Mm. Jack Benny did a picture with him called To Be or Not to Be. And I said to Jack one time, I said, how is that working with Lubitsch? And he said, "Oh, great." He said, "Well, I heard he acted out all the parts." He said, "It's true." I said, "Well, was he any good?" And Jack said, "Well, he was a little broad, but you got the idea."
So is that one of the reasons you've been so good with up-and-coming actors? You've had a lot of newcomers?
I think so. I have a lot to do with the performances when they're new. Unless you have somebody like Madeline Kahn, who had acted in the theater and so on, so she was very professional. Mm-hmm. And I had to handle her a little differently. But she knew what she was doing. She was great.
So did Sybil Shepherd make her first movie with
you? I had to work with her pretty closely.
And Jeff Bridges was still pretty young, but he...
But Jeff was a pro.
Already a pro.
Jeff was a pro at 19. Mm. And Tatum, of course, that performance had to be directed. Mm. You know, had to. She didn't know what she was doing. She was a kid. But she did it. That's what I see that movie sometimes, and there's that one scene in the car at the end of Act One, which I asked the writer to write, because I said, we need a scene where they argue and fight and almost break up, and then they end up closer than ever. And Alvin wrote a brilliant scene, a five-page scene, and I said, we have to do this in one shot. Mm. Well, 25 takes later, we didn't get it the first day. Came back about 3 days later, another 15 takes, we got it finally. And whenever I see it, I tear up a little bit because that fucking kid did it. It was a very difficult scene.
Yeah.
Because she had all the dialogue and she had all the business. She had to take the box and put it in the back and put the radio in her lap and do it, open the map and all. To this day, I don't know how I thought she could do it, but she did it.
So what's so it like to
that see? Was the scene that got her the Oscar, in my opinion.
Yeah. I think you're right. So what's it like to see somebody like Sybil Shepherd go from kind of being created to kind of finding her way to becoming a real pro?
Well, she was good right away. I mean, she had a great sense of humor. And I would say, why don't you try this? And she'd say, oh, that's very funny, and she'd do it. Hmm. And she was willing, and she was very good. And she was good right away. But I mean, she had to be helped. But she, you know, like I'd say, close your eyes tight there. And she'd say, oh, that's funny, and she did it. But you know, but she did it. A lot of scenes without a cut that she did.
Mm. And Imogen Poots, who's in this movie.
Oh my God, Imogen's brilliant.
And she's done a lot. She has quite a long career.
You just have to let her loose. She's brilliant.
Mm. But she seems to be one of those actors who really disappears into the role.
Completely. She has a scene where she has to do an audition. And she has to convince. She had to, in that scene, had to convince the audience that she could really be an actor, that she was really good. Mm-hmm. So they ran it through once, and they were playing it for laughs, and I said, no, we can't do that. This has got to be played straight. We've got to believe that she really gave a great audition. Otherwise, why is the wife pushing for her to be in the picture, in mm-hmm. the play? So I said to Imogen, I said, an audience won't believe you're a great actress unless you can cry. If you cry, they think, oh, she must be a great actress. So cry a little bit. So she cried. I said, okay, great. I went over to her and I said to her, listen, darling. I whispered in her, I said, you cried, great, but you screwed up your face too much. I want you to be beautiful when you cry. She said, Jesus, Peter. But she did it. That's kind of, but she was great. Great stuff she did.
Is there? Do you know as a director when somebody like that it comes along that you're going to get what you need, that they can hit those notes as you request?
Yeah, because tell you the truth, she came up from Atlanta to New York to see me at the Palm Court at the Plaza Hotel. And she sat down and we talked for about 15 minutes. And after 15 minutes, I said, don't tell anybody, but you got the part. Because, first of all, she's English, which means she can do anything in terms of accents or any of that stuff. The English are brilliant actors, let's face it. And they have tradition, they have great schooling, they're just brilliant. Mm-hmm. So I knew she could play it. But why she got the part so quickly was because she was quirky, she was unusual, she was very eccentric, she's weird, mm-hmm. but charming. And unlike some actors, she wasn't trying to be eccentric or quirky, she just was. So I figured with her being quirky and eccentric, mm-hmm. in this part, it'll just be more interesting. Mm-hmm. So I cast her.
So is that how
you... And everybody said, Peter, are you sure? And you didn't read her or anything?
Have you cast most of your actors that way? Or
Tatum. I mean, Tatum never read for me. Sybil never read for me. Madeline never read for me. Mm. Those are all people I introduced. Sandra Bullock didn't read for me, but we had a tape of her doing a reading. Mm. Which, that's cheating.
Well, she seemed weirdly destined, Sandra Bullock. It was like she got shot after shot after shot. It was like the casting people all knew that she was going to be a star somehow.
Well, Paramount fought me for a month on didn't want her. Mm. And I fought and fought, and I said, she's going to be great. You got to use her. And that's how she got Speed from my picture, Jan de Bont told me.
Mm. So does a movie like Mask different in your list of films for you? I guess the majority of your films have been comedies.
Not really.
No?
Daisy Miller, St. Jack, The Last Picture Show, they weren't comedies.
You don't consider The Last Picture Show a comedy? No. I think most people do now.
Well, it's a very weird comedy.
St. Jack, definitely not.
Daisy Miller is not funny. No, I don't think they're all comedies.
But do you see are they different to you as whether they're dramas or comedies in terms of?
Yeah, it's a different tempo. Different tempo, different. It's different. Comedies are different.
And do you feel differently about the result, the resulting film?
Well, the comedies are more difficult in a way. Because if they don't laugh, I'm sorry, it didn't work. Mm-hmm. With the drama, you can say, well, it's a drama, they're not laughing. Mm-hmm. What's the question?
Just whether you hold the films in a different way, you know, you're kind of known for films like What's Up, Doc, and those kind of comedies that have this kind of spirit and this joy to them, and then you've made some very serious dramas.
Well, I try to get humor into the dramas. You know, there's a lot of places in picture show that are funny, even though it's basically a sad story. Mm. But there are a lot of laughs in it. I put laughs into Daisy Miller, too, because I think it's horrible to make a movie with no laughs in it. Mm. But they're different. I like to keep the pace going, even in a drama. Mm-hmm. Tempo. Keep it moving right along, you know.
And when a movie like At Long Last Love comes along and audiences...
Well, there's a long story about that. That picture was completely screwed up in the first release. We had two previews, an original musical comedy, for Christ's sake. They take them on the road for Broadway for a month or two. Mm-hmm. We had two previews, and then we opened with a cut that wasn't previewed. Mm. Disaster. Disaster.
So are you happy with any of the cuts that you ended up with?
Then I did another cut, which was on television, I thought. Mm. 30 years went by, and somebody calls me and says, At Long Last Love is streaming on Netflix. I said, oh, really? Hadn't seen it in years, so I put it on Netflix. Mm. I'm watching. I said, I cut that scene. Why is it in there? What the hell? What is this cut? But it's good. Mm-hmm. I watched the whole picture. It was really good. It was a cut I had nothing to do with. It was a little bit, it was close to my first preview cut. Mm-hmm. First preview, which means it was pretty inclusive. And this had scenes that I had cut that were back in, songs that I had cut that were out, I mean that I'd left in that were out, completely different. Huh. I got in touch with Fox and I said, where the fuck did this print come from? This cut come from? Mm-hmm. They looked it up, they said, well, a guy named Jim Blakely, who was the head of editorial at Fox for years, he had died 2 years before, did the cut. And it's been available since 1979. So all those years that people came up to me and said, I saw the film on TV, mm-hmm. why did it get such bad reviews? It's very good. That was his cut.
So you should have hired him in the first place.
Yeah. I called Jim Giannopoulos at Fox and I said, I told him the story. He said, wait a minute, let me get this straight. You're telling me there's a cut that exists that you didn't do that you like? I said, yeah, I love it. He said, that's a history.
That is the first time ever.
That's history.
Story.
Anyway, that was lucky.
So was that movie like a great experiment in terms of trying to get non-singers to sing and trying to do a live takes and everything else?
Yeah, it works in the Jim Blakely's cut.
But I mean, was that the drive to do something different?
Or yeah, it was an attempt to do a musical that was aware of itself being a musical, which is a little bit what Lubitsch used to do. Mm-hmm. He made the first five great musicals at Paramount and Metro. And they were kind of kidding it at the same time as they were celebrating it. And that's what we tried to do. Mm. Same idea. And Jim Blakely got it right.
So did the period where you were writing about films end up being incredibly significant in terms of who you became as a director?
Well, in a way, yes, because I got to interview a lot of people. What happened was I was out of work, having done The Big Knife, and didn't have anything behind it ready to go. And I didn't get called by Hollywood to come out and direct, as I hoped I would. Mm-hmm. So instead, I started writing about films in little film society things, you know, for a quarter. And this guy, Dan Talbot, who was an exhibitor and a writer and so on, opened a theater, bought a theater and reopened it as the New Yorker Theater on 88th and Broadway, which was two blocks from where I was living with my parents. And I went in to see him and I said, I live near you, I'd like to come in free. Mm-hmm. I wrote a program note on intolerance. Did you see that? He said, yeah, it was lousy. I said, yeah, I know it was lousy. And I started writing program notes for that theater for $15 or something. Mm-hmm. And I wrote a program note on Orson Welles' Othello. And I said it was the best Shakespeare movie ever made, which was absolutely not the common wisdom at that point at all. Mm-hmm. It was a absolutely unorthodox statement. Mm-hmm. I get a call shortly thereafter from the curator of the Museum of Modern Art, Dick Griffith. He said, we're doing an Orson Welles retrospective, the first in the United States, and we'd like you to curate it and write the accompanying monograph. I said, why me? You usually do that. He says, well, I don't like Orson Welles, but we have a lot of members who do, mm-hmm. and we have a lot of people in Europe who think he's great and so on. And you obviously think he's great because we read your program note on Othello. We'd like somebody who's sympathetic to write this. So I took it, I did it. And then I went to Hollywood for the first time about a year later, I can't remember now what the order of events was, to see if I could get Odets to give me another play to do. Mm. I didn't succeed, but I knew everybody in the movie studios, mm-hmm. the publicity people, and I went to and met a lot of people. And I wrote a piece about it for Harper's, because they said they would read anything I wrote. They turned it down, the New Yorker turned it down, and then I met Harold Hayes at Esquire. Mm-hmm. He bought it and loved it and used it as an opening piece in the August issue of 62. And then I started writing for Esquire. That's how that happened. And I did two more monographs and two more shows for the Museum of Modern Art. Mm-hmm. I got Universal to pay for Hitchcock's The Birds opening, and they paid for the whole thing. I got money for that. Hmm. And convinced Paramount and the museum to do Hawks with Hatari. So I did three in a row and was writing for Esquire and wrote a long piece about John Ford, watched him work for 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, I was interviewing these people at the same time, learning a lot. And I was just a kid. I was only 23 or something. And then I did another play, which was a flop. Mm. I didn't do an Odez play. I did a play which was a long story, but anyway, it didn't work. Mm-hmm. And so I was rather depressed. And Frank Tashlin, who I had met doing a piece about Jerry Lewis, came to New York and said, what do you want to direct, movies or theater? I said, movies. Well, what are you doing in New York? He said, we make them in L.A. Well, nobody had said it quite as clearly before. And the next thing I knew, 6 months later, we moved to California, my first wife and I, mm-hmm. in 1964.
So you were really a director through all of that period.
Yeah.
People, I mean, as you said, people think of you as a,
yeah,
they could, a critic turned.
Yeah, no, it was. I started directing when I was 19 and directed 7 plays up in Phoenician, New York, in the summer theater, and directed another play in New York, and so on. Mm-hmm. And I was acting in showcases, too, when I was mm-hmm. my teens. But the writing made a name for me before the directing. Mm-hmm. So when Roger Corman, when I accidentally met Roger Corman in a movie theater in here, out in Los Angeles, he said, I read your stuff in Esquire. Would you like to write a movie? I said, yeah, sure. So that's how I got my first job writing for Corman. And then he asked me to help him with The Wild Angels. And then I ended up doing the second unit on that. And that's how I got Targets. Hmm.
So will your movie be in Lincoln Plaza Cinemas? Will this movie be in Lincoln Plaza Cinema with Dan Talbot?
I don't know. It's a good question.
That's a long history. That's the...
We had a falling out at one point.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah. But I don't know. I don't know if it'll be shown there.
But is there that camaraderie? Do you have people, that group of people who are still from those days who are left? Who are...
George Morfogen, the actor. Mm-hmm. I've known him since I was 18. Mm. That's about it, though. Mm.
But you're kind of continuing on.
Well, you know, what else am I going to do?
Well, it's a rare thing for somebody of your age to still be directing films.
Well, Clint's 85.
That's true. And the British all do it.
And there was a director recently who was Spanish. I think he was 101.
Yes. Well, the British act directors, they're those in their 70s and early 80s that still do it.
Yeah, it's fine.
But in Hollywood, they seem to kind of cut everybody off.
Well, Hollywood is ageist.
Yeah.
And sexist.
And racist.
And racist. All the ists.
Yes, we're all very proud.
Yeah. But I didn't have any problem directing this picture. I enjoyed it.
Excellent. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hope you got what you wanted. I have no idea what I said.
You were terrific.